The Bible tells us, I was looking at some scriptures this morning, the Bible tells us in the book of James, the fifth chapter, says, second half of the verse, it says that the effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And you know, I want that to be my life. I want to have effective and fervent prayers. But beyond effective and fervent prayers, I want to have prayers that avail much. I want to pray prayers that mean something. I want to pray prayers that God hears and responds to. I want to pray prayers that aren't boring and traditional. I want to pray prayers that are full of power and might and inspiration of the Holy Spirit. This last week, I had the opportunity to attend a memorial service for one of my family members, and my wife's grandmother, and she's a Catholic, and it was so neat to see that type of a service and to see just the commitment and the dedication of the people within that service, and they would begin to pray, and everybody would pray together, and everybody knew the prayers. But at the same time, I don't want to just pray tradition. I don't want to just pray a ritual. I don't want to just pray something because somebody taught me. And I don't want to just pray out of naivety. You know, as a dad, I love this season I'm in with my children. My favorite time of the day is the night, is bedtime. Not because I get grown-up time, you know, I get the me time. We get to watch the grown-up TV and not like VeggieTales and all the other things. Not because Stacy and I get to look at each other's eyes and kind of remember what it was like before kids and toddlers. I get to enjoy that time because as we put our kids to bed, we always talk about what the day was like and we always pray. And we taught our children Matthew chapter 6, and they can quote the Lord's Prayer. My son Bjorn, he just gets a kick out of showing anybody that he can quote the Lord's Prayer, and he's so happy about it. And one of my favorite things to do is just to listen to their prayers. To listen to the prayers of a 5-year-old, to listen to the prayers of a 3-year-old. You know, and they pray for everything. They pray for anything. You know, we had our refrigerator. I remember our refrigerator wasn't working. Or one time our air conditioning, the register that you put the fan, or the air conditioning filter in, the register fell off the ceiling and fell onto the ground and it chipped Daddy's wood floors. And I remember Bjorn was praying and he said, Lord, I pray that you would fix the air conditioner. I pray that you would make the refrigerator cold. I pray for the squirrels. I pray for our doggies. And then my little 3-year-old, it's like whenever she prays, she starts crying. Like praying is a crying thing. And she's like got this little like, Lord, Jesus, pray for mommy and daddy. Pray for safety and that we have a good night and good dreams. And as a dad, I'm just like, oh, it's amazing. I love it. But at the same time, I think sometimes we kind of pray like that, unknowing. We pray like toddlers when God wants us to pray like spiritual Christians. Our prayers are safe. Our prayers are comfortable. God, protect me. God, speak to me. God, bless me. God, help me. And they're all wrapped around comfort. They're all wrapped around safety. They're all wrapped around security. And as we talk about the subject and the title of the message is Prayer is Blank, because we'll fill it in. The title of tonight I want to talk about is Prayer is Dangerous. Prayer is dangerous. Now, I don't want you to think, oh my goodness, Pastor Luke's telling me not to pray. No, I want you to understand the context of what danger is. I remember when I was a kid, my parents took me to the Hoover Dam, right there at the Colorado River. And the Hoover Dam has the power of the mighty Colorado and Lake Mead behind it. And as they take the water from the bottom of Lake Mead, hundreds of feet deep, the water is pushed through these massive turbines and you can just hear them spinning and churning, and as the power of the water spins and as it churns, you can just feel the electricity in the air as it generates electricity to power California and Las Vegas and the various areas. And right there, as you go through the generation room at Hoover Dam, there's massive signs everywhere, all over the place. Danger. Or for the Spanish speakers, right? Peligro. Right? With the little triangle and the lightning bolt. Because there's immense power in those generators. There's a great deal of electricity that's being made and being created. And to somebody who doesn't have a level of respect, a level of position, or a level of understanding of what could happen if you got close or you misused or you didn't respect what those generators do, you could be harmed, you could be hurt, you could be killed by those. And you see, prayer tonight, I want to talk about prayer is dangerous. It's dangerous to your comfort zone. It's dangerous to your safety. It's dangerous to your flesh. And most of all, it's dangerous to the spirit of darkness in this world. There's power behind it and a respect behind it. And so often what happens is I believe that when we get wrapped into prayer, we get wrapped into God, I need you to bless me. God, I need you to speak to me. God, I need you to keep me. God, I need you to do everything I need you to do. God, I need finances. God, I need provision. God, I need comfort. God, I need safety. God, I need security. And we get wrapped up in the American dream. We get wrapped up in civilization. We get wrapped up in culture. And we get wrapped up in comfort and safety and security. But you see, prayer is not safe. Prayer is not comfortable. Prayer is not complacent. Prayer is dangerous. It's dangerous. And today I want to talk about dangerous prayers. Because you see, the Bible tells us in Isaiah, the 55th chapter, God speaking to you and I. The Bible says to you and I, it says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways." And you know what's so often what happens is I find in my own life that we begin to pray. I begin to pray and I begin to ask God, "God, my will, not yours, be done. God, I want this in my life. Please make it happen. God, I want my dreams to look like this. Please make them come to pass. God, my business plans, I want them to look like this. Please make it happen. God, I want my commute to work to look like this. Please make it happen. God, I want my wife to look like this. Please make it happen. God, I want my husband to look like this. Please make it happen." And my prayers are me, are mine, are I. You see, God says, "Look, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways." As a matter of fact, God says it like this. In verse number 9, he says it like this. He says, "For my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. And my ways are higher or greater than your ways." Like a stepping stone, like a ladder, you and I, we stand at the base looking up and we say, "I got to get to the top." But have you ever climbed on a ladder? Has anybody ever been on a ladder, particularly a tall ladder? I remember back in the day when I used to work maintenance in the church, one of our jobs in maintenance was to go on this massive ladder and to dust the top of the air conditioners because they were all exposed, the ducting. So we had to have this big 35-foot ladder and we had to lean it against the air conditioning vents. And as you would walk on this extension ladder, it would sway. And every step you took, exposure got more and more and more and more until you're about 25 feet up in the air. And it's like every little move, every little millimeter of movement, you felt it, you jostled and you struggled. And as you reached, you just worked as hard as you could to just dust it so that it wouldn't fall on the little kitties and the little dust bunnies wouldn't go on the kids. And prayer is much like that. You see, God says, "My ways are higher. My thoughts are higher." God says, "You're standing at the base of a great ladder. You're standing at the base of a great journey." And God says, "I want to take you somewhere. I want to take you something higher. I want to take you to a place that's greater, that the elevation, that the view is so different than what you see at sea level." He says, "I want to take you to the top, but every step of your journey, it's going to increase your exposure. And every step you take, you're going to start to feel the air underneath you. And exposure is danger because you realize how far up you are. You realize how far out you are. You realize now all of a sudden it's not my prayers anymore that I'm praying. These are God's prayers that I'm praying. And there's nothing underneath me but air, which means that everything I'm praying has to work because if these fail, I fall and I cannot fall." Those are dangerous prayers. And God says, "Church, I don't want you to live safe and comfortable and complacent. He says, I want you to get exposed. I want you to get on the ladder of the Holy Spirit. My ways are higher than your ways. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. And I want to take you one step at a time, up and up and up and up and up, until you look at your life and you look back and say, the view from up here, as the heavens are higher than the earth, the view from up here is amazing. So that when we read scriptures like Ephesians 3:20, that our God is exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think. That's the wrong scripture reference. Was it right? That was just off the cuff of my head. So all right, I'm like, no, that's 3:20. We look at that and we realize, you know what? That comes not because I'm sitting comfortable. Not because I'm praying boring prayers. Not because I'm falling asleep when I pray. But because I'm dangerous. Because I'm living on the edge. Because I'm standing on the ladder and I can feel the wind blowing underneath me. And now all of a sudden I look down and I can see perspective, not from my view any longer, but from God's views. Because those are dangerous prayers. Jesus prays dangerous prayers. Think about the dangerous prayer Jesus prayed. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's about to go to the cross. And Jesus says, Lord, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. My flesh is telling me it's going to hurt. I'm afraid. I don't know what's going to happen right now. And he says, if there's any chance that this cup can pass, if there's any opportunity for this dangerous prayer to move on to something a little bit more comfortable, he says, man, I'd love to see that. But look what he says. Nevertheless, dangerous prayer. A dangerous prayer, he says, nevertheless, not my will, but your be done. Dangerous prayers. Living on the edge. And today I want to talk about dangerous prayers, and I want to pray dangerous prayers. Can we get into some dangerous prayers tonight? Does anybody feel like getting a little bit dangerous for Jesus in this place? But understand that dangerous prayers are dangerous. And you know, they always say, be careful what you pray for, because you just might get it. And if you pray for dangerous things, you just might get it. But you know what? That's where God wants us to be. For my thoughts are not your thoughts. For my ways are not your ways. They're higher, they're greater. Today, I want to look at dangerous prayers. I'm just going to take you through three dangerous prayers that we can see in illustrations and ideas of that through the Word of God. And then after we look at each one of those dangerous prayers, here's what we're going to do. For those of you in this place, because you say, I want to pray a dangerous prayer, but maybe after you hear about the dangerous prayer, you don't want to pray a dangerous prayer. But for those of you that you want to pray dangerous prayers, we're going to pray together. I'll have you stand and we'll do it together. And we're going to pray a dangerous prayer and we're going to call down the Holy Spirit on us. And then after that, we're going to sing songs. That in these songs, you may not even recognize that as you sing in church, they're songs that you know. These are dangerous prayers that you've been singing, didn't even recognize and realize that you've been singing dangerous prayers. But now that you're aware and awake of the dangerous prayers that you're singing, now we're going to sing it. We're going to cry out to the Holy Spirit. Just let Him speak and let Him move. And we're going to allow the Holy Spirit to just work and do His thing in your heart and do His thing in your life. Can we do that today? So let's talk about some dangerous prayers. Dangerous prayers. First dangerous prayer I want to talk about tonight is this. Search my heart. Search my heart. That's a dangerous prayer. That's a dangerous prayer. It's not a risky prayer. It's a dangerous prayer. You see, we like to live sheltered lives. We like to live lives where we, you know what? I want to know everything as long as it's good. And if it's bad, I just want to know the brief headline and just kind of want to focus on positive things. And we want to kind of shelter ourselves from everything. And even so much so that we live sheltered lives or we live distant lives, that sometimes we even get a little bit ignorant on ourselves. We begin to believe the things that we tell ourselves because we're sheltered in our own heart and in our own lives. I'm not as bad as I think I am. That's not as bad of an issue as I think it is. That person over there, they've really got a problem. And when you look at them and me, you know, I'm doing okay. You know what, I feel like I'm all right. You know, yeah, that one person, they hurt me and they said those things about me, but we're okay. When in reality, on the inside, there's things that you haven't addressed. There's things that you haven't looked at. There's things that you haven't spoken to. You know, have you ever been on a diet in the place? Anybody ever dieted? It's okay to say yes. Amen. I diet all the time. Never thought I'd have to do that. You know, and I was on this diet in January. We did this Daniel fast. And after we did the Daniel fast, I kind of tried to keep on that and say, like, I'm going to eat healthy. And it was kind of funny. At the end of the day, I'd look back and be like, you know, I didn't do that bad. I did pretty good today. And then I'd step on the scale and be like, you gained 2 pounds this week. How did I gain 2 pounds this week when I'm dieting? I'm like, no, I did good. I did all right. But if I look past the ignorance, well, I ate 5 Oreos. I had cheesecake for breakfast. And I had a bunch of soda when I had dinner. But in my mind, I think, no, you know what? I did good. I was doing good. I didn't eat processed foods for dinner. I had broccoli. And because I had broccoli, I did good. Sometimes our prayers get like that. Sometimes our walk with God gets like that. You know what? I went to church today. I'm good. You know, I felt the goosebumps in the music. I'm good and everything's good. And I'm not so bad and there's nothing in my heart. There's nothing in my life that I need to work on. But you see, a dangerous prayer says, search me, oh God. Like the psalmist says in Psalms 139, search me and know my heart, oh God. Try me and know my anxieties. Verse number 24, and see if there is wicked in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. To ask God to reveal the hurt, to reveal the pain, to reveal the bitterness, to reveal the ignorance, to reveal the sin, to reveal the shame that we hold on to and we think that we're okay because we want to mask it and insulate ourselves from it. It's a dangerous prayer because we ask God to show it. Guess what He's going to do? He's going to show it. He's going to reveal it. You see, God wants you and I to come to Him with a whole heart, with an open heart, with an open life to Him. To say, God, I'm not going to hold back. God, I'm not going to give you some of me. God, when I say I'm going to give you all of me, I mean I'm going to give you all of me. And that means the deepest little things in my heart that I didn't even know I had because I was insulated from them. But I pray a dangerous prayer. God, search my heart. Search my heart and know me. Try me. God, show me my anxiety. Show me my issues. Show me my thoughts. Show me the areas of my life that I need to work on. God, would you reveal to me the things in my life that you want me with your power to work on? Nobody wants the bad news. Nobody wants the drama. But a dangerous prayer says, God, take me there. Take me there on the inside. Today, as we pray, are you willing to pray a dangerous prayer? To say, God, I don't want to live a life of ignorance. God, I don't want to live a life where I say I believe in you, but my life doesn't reflect it because there are things that I have not yet been tried in. Like Paul the Apostle says, God, I'm inviting you to turn up the fire in my life and to refine me. To burn away the wood, the hay, and the stubble and reveal what's left in my heart, the gold and the silver and the precious stones. But Lord, fire hurts. And it's a journey and it's a struggle and it's dangerous. But Lord, you want all of me. 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 And if I'm going to give you all of me, then God, I'm going to give you all of me. The good and the bad. The right and the wrong. And I'm going to let you start burning away. Start refining the wrong. Start refining the bad. And bring me to a place through the grace of Jesus Christ that puts me in the position that you want me to be. Are you tonight willing to get a little dangerous and pray a prayer for God to search your heart, for God to search your life, to reveal the things inside of you that He wants you to look at, to focus on. If you are today, let's stand and let's pray. Let's pray a dangerous prayer. If you want to stand, you can stand. If you want to kneel, you can kneel. You can do whatever you want. But you know what? If that's you in this place, and you know what? If you say, you know what, Pastor Luke, right now I'm not in the place where I just want to do that. Hey, listen, that's all right. You can pray right now. You can pray. But let's pray dangerous prayers tonight. Let's just go before the Lord. Father, we come before You. And Lord, in my own life, I could just say that my flesh is scared. Lord, I don't want to know. I don't want to know what's looming in the closets. I don't want to know what's buried deep beneath. Lord, I don't want to bring that up because I'm happy. I'm content and I'm safe and I'm comfortable. But Lord, I know that You called me to go higher. Lord, I know that You called me to go deeper. Lord, I know that You called us to go wider. And so, Father, right now, Lord, right now, we lift our hands to You, Father, and we offer. Lord, we invite. Lord, we unlock the hardness of our hearts. Lord, we unlock the calluses of our lives. Father, we give them and we surrender them and we open them to You, Lord, and we begin to pray the dangerous prayers like Jesus prayed. Lord, not my will, but Yours be done. And Lord, we begin to ask the things that are in our life, God, that are not Your will for us. Lord, I pray that You would begin to search us. Search our hearts. Lord, search our lives. Reveal to us our anxieties. Reveal to us our issues. Reveal to us our doubts. Like the man cried out to Jesus, Lord, help my unbelief. Lord, help our unbelief. Fill us with Your Holy Spirit. Give us the grace and the direction to see what You want us to see, to shine light in the dark areas of our life that You want the light of Jesus to begin to work and operate in. And Father, we commit to pray dangerously, to live on the edge, to take a step of faith and to say, God, search our hearts because You want all of us. You want all of us. Lord, You want all of us. And today, Lord, we cry, search our hearts. Search our lives because we give You all. We love You with all. And we give it to You today. We open our hearts to You. Lord, search us and speak to us in our times. Now we're going to sing. And as we sing and as the praise and worship team sings, if you want to continue in prayer, if God's speaking to you right now, you pray. If God's leading you right now, if He's revealing things in your heart right now, you pray. And let's pray and let's give and let's sing and bring in the presence of the Holy Spirit into our lives so that we can walk out of this little prayer meeting tonight full of the Holy Spirit and power today. Let's join together in song.
I love You with all my heart. And I love You with all my soul.
Lord, I ask as we pray dangerously, God, I pray that your grace would overshadow us. Lord, I pray that your strength would overpower us. Lord, I pray that your word would direct us and light us and lead us in your direction and, Father, in your path. Lord, as we cry out in that song, I'll worship with all that I am. I'll love you with all that I am. Lord, you ask for all of us. And Lord, we commit today to pray dangerously to say, Lord, search our hearts. And if there's anything that's within me that is not all of yours, God, I surrender it dangerously to you today. Fill that emptiness. Fill that void. Fill that place in my heart. And Lord, I thank you for your spirit to move in us. And Lord, we commit to pray this week dangerously to reveal yourself. To search us, God, as we go before you in our prayer closets. God, I ask that we would search you. And Lord, ask you to search us, speak to us, and lead us, your people, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can sit down. The next dangerous prayer I want to talk about is break me. The first prayer we talked about is search me. The next dangerous prayer is break me. You see, we get so wrapped up in us. We get so wrapped up in our thoughts. We get so wrapped up in our minds. We get so wrapped up in our opinions. We get so wrapped up in our world. We get so caught up in time that we lose the essence of what God has for us, and that is compassion and a broken heart. In a book that Pastor Deborah always talks about, Love Covers, Billenheimer writes this. He writes this about the church, and he says that the greatest sin that the church commits, the body of Christ commits, is the sin of disunity. Because we are one body, connected and united through Jesus Christ. And he says within disunity, the greatest sin is the pride of life or of position. To say, you know what, it's my way. It's my thoughts, it's my ideas, it's my plans, it's my directions, it's my hopes, it's my dreams, it's my words, it's my prayers. And we have a tendency to be cold. You think about it when you drive past that person holding up the sign, because we see it all day long. We think to ourselves, man, you know what? They did that to themselves. They got themselves there. You know what? If they wouldn't have got wrapped up in drugs, if they wouldn't have gotten wrapped up in making those stupid decisions, if they wouldn't got wrapped up with that person, and if I give them my money, as the signs all over the cities and everything say, if I give them the money, my money, all I'm doing is enabling them. And because of that thought, we shut off to the world, to that person that God loves, to that person that God sent Jesus to die for that you can't stand. They bug you, or they hurt you, or they've wronged you. We say, forget you. I don't care about you. I don't want to think about you. I don't want to give any more of my time to you. I want to shut you out of my life. We close off. And a dangerous prayer for you and me is a prayer to God that says, break that. Break that. Break that. In my life. God, I don't want to be a cold-hearted Christian. I want to be like Jesus Christ. I want to be like Jesus. And the Bible says time and time again, Jesus saw them and he was moved with compassion. They cried out to him all the louder and he was filled with compassion. Then he looked at them in their ignorance and he loved them. And we can get so wrapped up in us. So wrapped up in our world, so wrapped up in our thoughts, so wrapped up in our opinions, so wrapped up in our hopes and our own dreams that we become closed and callous to everything else. And the dangerous prayer that we pray is, Lord, break me. Lord, break me. Because I want to be broken for you so that you can use me for your will, for your way. The Bible gives us all sorts of illustrations and all sorts of stories and likeness of us. And Jesus even gives us the illustration of himself. And the Bible tells us that in the Last Supper that Jesus, he took the bread and he broke it. He broke it. And he said, this is my body, which is given for you. As often as you eat this, do so in remembrance of me. If you remember the story of the fish and the loaves, the little boy's loaves and the little boy's fish, he took the bread and he offered it up to God and he broke it. You see, we have to be broken before we can be multiplied. And it's a dangerous prayer to ask God, break me so you can multiply me. Because that means you're going to get soft when you want to be hard. That means that you're going to cry when you want to be tough. That means that you're not going to be able to get through something that you used to be able to get through. That means that when somebody looks at you, they're going to see a softy instead of that machismo. Elijah talked about Pastor Sherm. I don't know if he did it this morning. I don't know if you heard about it or not, but Pastor Sherm, World War II veteran, construction, hard life, here and there, but every time you talked about Jesus, he'd start crying. Because he was broken. I can say on the front row, my mother, Pastor Deborah, not a day goes by, Mom, where you're not praying or crying for something, for somewhere, someone somewhere. And God says, I want you to get out of yourself. I want you to get off of yourself. Don't get wrapped up in the pride of self-opinion and the pride of life. Are you willing to pray a dangerous and a scary prayer that says, God, break me. Break my heart. Break my pride. Break my opinion so that you could use me? Because that's a dangerous prayer. You got to be careful what you ask for. Because you ask for it, God's going to do it. So today, if you're in this place and you say, you know what? I want to do something for the kingdom of God. And I look at my life and sometimes I get moved, but sometimes I stand there cold and I wonder, what's wrong? And like Jesus, who is moved with compassion, I want to look over San Bernardino. I want to look over the poor. I want to look and see the needy. I want to look and see the rich who are empty. I want to see the wealthy. I want to see the successful. And I want to see not what the world sees in them. I want to see what God sees in them. A soul that needs Jesus just like everybody else. Are you willing to be dangerous for Jesus tonight? And to pray a dangerous prayer to say, Lord, break me so that you can use me. If you are, let's pray. Come on, stand to your feet if that's you. Kneel, whatever you want to do. If you don't want to be broken, that's all right. You can pray. Right now, as we pray, you pray. Maybe you want to pray for your neighbor. You want to pray for your healing. You want to pray for something like that. You pray. That's what we're here doing. We're praying. But if you want to be used by God, let's live a little dangerously today. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you set the ultimate example, Jesus Christ. Lord, the religious, the well-off, they were offended by Jesus. They asked your disciples, why does Jesus hang out with tax collectors and sinners? Why doesn't he spend his time with the well-off and the religious? And Jesus said, because I came for the sick and the lost. So Lord, we pray as your word says, your ways are not our ways, your thoughts are not our thoughts, your ways are higher, your ways are greater, your thoughts are higher, your ways are greater. Lord, we ask right now dangerously in our lives, Lord, we ask that you would begin to break our hearts. Lord, that you would reveal to us a softness of Jesus. Lord, that you would see and show us the desire of God. Lord, that we would see the humanity of this world. Lord, we would see the sin of this world. We would see the brokenness of this world. We would see the vanity of this world. We would see the traps of this world. And God, we would be like your son, and we would be moved with compassion, not closed with bitterness and offense and a hardness, but God, that our hearts would be soft and tender and pliable for your will, for your ways, and for your desire. Lord, teach us, your people, to have a broken heart, to use us for your kingdom, to use us for your will. And Lord, if that means we surrender the pride of life, God, take it from us. Because the only thing that we have to stand on is not the pride of ourselves, but on the faith in Jesus and the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, break our hearts. Break us for your kingdom like that bread that was broken. Jesus, his body was broken for you and I. Lord, break us for your kingdom today as we sing, cry out to God today.
Everything I am for your kingdom's cause, and as I walk from earth into eternity.
Your grace. Thank you for your mercy on us, Lord. Lord, we just ask that you would open up our hearts, soften our hearts, soften our lives. Lord, we pray that dangerous prayer of break me for your kingdom. Break me for your purpose. Break me for your use. And Lord, as you break me, Lord, multiply me for your goodness and your glory. In Jesus' mighty name. You can sit down. The last and final dangerous prayer I want to talk about tonight. We've talked about the dangerous prayer of search me, the dangerous prayer of break me, and the last prayer today I want to pray. It's so dangerous. It's the dangerous prayer of send me. Send me. Send me. God, I want you to send me as long as it's in my comfort. God, I want you to send me as long as it's to the people that I like. God, I want you to send me as long as it caters to my talent and to my ability. God, I want you to send me to places that smell good, that have good food. Lord, I want you to send me to Orange County. The dangerous prayer of send me. Send me. Because we all have this idea of what it means to be sent by God. You see, God says, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are higher, and they're greater, and my thoughts are higher, and they're greater. And God says, I got somewhere I want you to go. And that somewhere I want you to go might be the darkest corners of the earth, or that somewhere I want you to go might be the darkest corners of a nursery. That somewhere I want you to go might be to that person in the workplace. That somewhere I want you to go might be that neighbor. That somewhere I want you to go might be somewhere you have no idea what's going to happen. And a dangerous prayer says, Lord, send me. Because I don't know where you're going to take me. I don't know what you're going to do with me. Jesus, when he sent his disciples, he says, listen, I want you to go out in twos. I don't want you to take money. I don't want you to take extra clothes. I don't want you to take anything. I want you to go to the town, and I want you to go, and I want you to preach. Knock on the door. If they don't want you, shake the dust from your feet, and you keep on going. And if they'll take you, you stay, and you preach the gospel. You tell them what I've told you. And as they returned, as he sent his disciples out, they returned, they said, Jesus, we can't believe it. We can't believe it, what we saw. We saw that demons were cast out. We saw people delivered. We saw that the sick were healed. Jesus said, you gotta go. You gotta go. You gotta go. You can't stay here anymore. You can't stay in your comfort zone anymore. You gotta go. There's a place for you to go. And not every person is called to Africa. Not every person is called to Asia. Not every person is called to Orange County, praise God. Not every person is called to be a pastor or an evangelist or a teacher. But every person is called to be sent of Jesus Christ. And maybe it's time for you to say, I'm going to accept the call. I'm going to accept the call to work with the youth. I'm going to accept the call to change stinky diapers in the nursery, to witness to babies. I'm going to accept the call to share Jesus in the workplace. I'm going to accept the call to write something on my sidewalk in chalk so every person that walks by sees the gospel. I'm going to accept the call to do something for Jesus, because that's a dangerous prayer right there. Dangerous to say, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go. And I'm going to step out in faith. But that's what God wants us. God was speaking to Isaiah, and he says these things. He says, man, I was looking. I needed somebody to go. And Isaiah says these words. He says, here I am. Send me. That's a dangerous prayer. That's a dangerous prayer. God, here I am. Send me to the nursery. Here I am. Send me to the Mexico missions. Here I am. Send me to step out in faith and support something. Here I am. Send me to tell somebody about you. That's a dangerous prayer. But God says, hey, listen, I don't want you to stay here. You've already been praying, search me. You've already been praying, break me. You didn't pray that for nothing. You prayed that so you can finish the dangerous prayer with, here I am, send me. And if that's you in this place and you say, you know what, I'm ready. I'm ready. I don't know where I'm ready to go. I don't know what I'm ready to do, but God, I'm ready to do something. I'm ready to do something. I'm ready to do something. I'm ready to do something for Jesus. If that's you in this place and you want to get a little dangerous, let's pray together. You know the routine by now. Stand up, kneel down, whatever it is. If you don't want to get dangerous, if you don't want to get sent, you can pray for something else right now. Well, let's get a little dangerous for Jesus. Send me. Father, we come before you. And Lord, we've asked that you search us. God, we've asked that you break us. And now we conclude by asking, God, you send us. Because, Lord, what we see, you don't see. Lord, what we feel, you don't feel. Lord, you see beyond what we see. Lord, you feel beyond what we feel. And Lord, you know what's around the corner. Lord, you know what's around the bend. Lord, you know where we need to go. Lord, you know what your plans are. You know what your purpose is for us. You know what your desire is for us. And so, Lord, we cry out like Isaiah cried out. Lord, here I am. Send me. Lord, send me. Lord, send me. Lord, I'm willing. Lord, I'll respond. Lord, I'll answer. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll be who you want me to be. God, send me. Help me to step out of the comfort zone, to step out of myself, to step out of my flesh, and God, to go and to be and to see what you've called me to go and to be and to see and to preach and to teach the gospel. Lord, we pray a dangerous prayer tonight. Send us to the highways and the byways, to the cities and to the fields, to the mountains and to the deserts. Send us to the depths of the city. Send us to our families. Send us to the nation. Send us to the world. Send us to your glory and to your kingdom. Lord, we say we're going to climb the ladder. We're going to live exposed. But Lord, here we are tonight. Send us. Send us in Jesus' name.
Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders.
Come on, lift your voice.
Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon.
Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for tonight. God, we ask that your Holy Spirit would move. Lord, this week we commit in our hearts. We commit in our lives, God, if we seek after you to pray dangerously, not just tonight. God, we take what we've learned. We take what we've seen tonight now, and Lord, we apply it to our prayers. Lord, we apply it to say, God, as we seek you, Lord, we'll ask, search my heart. Search my heart. Lord, we'll pray, God, break my heart. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Lord, we'll pray, send me where you want me to go. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor, because we pray that as you break us, you'll multiply us. A church that shines the light of the glory of the Most High God to this world that needs Jesus. We are the move of God today, because you will search us, break us, and send us to your places. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a great big praise. Amen. Praise God.